Hi, I'm Pia. I'm an economic researcher and I teach macroeconomics. In this video, we're going to learn about fiscal and monetary policy and how policy can help to stabilize the economy. In order to do so, we're going to start by defining the different types of public policy. Then, we're going to review the relevance of public policy with Keynesian economics. Then we'll explore how fiscal policy affects aggregate demand. And finally, we will do the same exercise with monetary policy. With this content, you'll be able to understand how public policy can stabilize the economy. So let's begin. Public policy is defined by the decisions and activities that are made by the government and implemented in order to serve the public. This, we may see, involves a key role from the public sector. This is because the government can act as a coordinator when an economy or industry faces imbalances. These policies can also be expansionary or contractionary. Expansionary policy aims to make GDP grow. Contractionary policy seeks to do the opposite. Why would a government try to do that? The most common example is when a government tries to cool down the economy when GDP is driven by prices or inflation. And finally, policies can either be cyclical or counter-cyclical. The first case consists on a policy that goes along with the economic cycle. For example, if a country is experiencing economic growth, a cyclical policy would be expansionary. If it were counter-cyclical, it would have to go in the opposite direction to the economic cycle. In this case, the policy should be contractionary. But what triggered this way of thinking? At the beginning of the 20th century, the economic conception was based on the laws of the market, where supply and demand were balanced with the price variable as the adjustment mechanism. Until that time, economic crises were based on scarcity, since production did not go hand in hand with population growth. With technological advances and the opening of international trade, these things changed. The economic crisis of 1929, which originated in the United States, led to a worldwide recession. It was here that for the first time, the problem was not scarcity, but overproduction. In other words, total production was not meeting demand. The drop in demand caused a drop in production. This was the first time that adjustments began to be made in the quantity produced and not in prices. This lower production eventually implied a reduction in employment levels. Fewer employed people generate a further fall in consumption and a consequent increase in poverty, which discourages production, and so on. Up to this point, the theories of classical economics had predicted that governments only had the role of ensuring the correct functioning of market laws, as well as the provision of public goods, such as education, water, or health. Faced with this recession and seeing the feedback between falling consumption and investment, there was a paradigm shift, Keynesian theory. Keynesian theory broke the scheme by talking mainly about two issues, demand and the public sector. First, demand stimulation. Considering that production levels were already higher, the economists detected the importance of promoting aggregate demand as a driver of the economy. This has to do with the Keynesian multiplier, which explains how impacts on demand translate on other variables such as investment, employment, and again, on output. According to Keynes, this factor is key for turning an economic recession into economic growth. There lies the importance of the public sector. The public sector in Keynesian theory occupies the role of coordinator and reactivator. According to Keynes, it is the only economic agent capable of carrying out a counter-cyclical policy to drive the economic cycle. In other words, to carry out expansionary policies in times of recession. This was the birth of what we know as the welfare state. But how is this mechanism? How can public policy influence aggregate demand? There are two main types of public policy to influence aggregate demand, fiscal and monetary. Fiscal policy involves economic regulation, tax policy, and government spending decisions, which can all have an effect on long-term growth through influencing the decisions that people and businesses make. This also includes investments such as education, healthcare, or infrastructure. What's most important for fiscal policy is that its main impact is on the market of goods and services. What's the logic in this? Let's see. There are two concepts that are key to understand these dynamics: the aggregate demand equation and the Keynesian multiplier. The aggregate demand equation is the same as total income. In other words, it's equal to the GDP equation. In order to keep it simple, we will use the equation for a closed economy. Let's suppose that the government implements an expansionary policy. For example, it decides to increase public expenditure on infrastructure. First of all, since public expenditure will rise, total GDP is expected to rise as well. These projects will require employees, so employment is also likely to rise. This will be positive for households, and it is expected to boost consumption. And firms are likely to see this as a good signal, so it is likely for investment to also be stimulated. Overall, these simultaneous adjustments on aggregate demand are caused by the multiplier, and the feedback that the government has on aggregate demand is what causes total income to grow. Keynes gave this type of policy a lot of significance during recessions as a stabilizer. In other words, he proposed countercyclical fiscal policy during recessions as a way to stabilize consumption and investment. With everything we've just covered, it's time for a quick exercise. After a boost on aggregate demand, it is likely for prices to rise and cause inflation. Let's assume that the government wants to do another fiscal policy to cool things down. What examples of contractionary fiscal policy can you think of? If you answered raising taxes or lowering public expenditure, then you are correct. In this case, the effect on aggregate demand will be the opposite. Consumption and investment will be discouraged, so total income will drop. Now let's turn to monetary policy. Monetary policy involves changes in the supply of money. To maintain a constant price of money growth, the government, more specifically the central bank, implements monetary policies. This aids in reducing excessive short-term growth and inflation, both of which have the potential to harm long-term growth. To alter the supply of money, a government may change the interest rate, alter the reserve requirements for banks, or buy or sell treasury notes. As opposed to fiscal policy, monetary policy influences mostly the money market. The money market is represented by the equilibrium between supply and demand for money. Money supply is exogenous and is the variable that will be shifted if monetary policy is implemented. Money demand is affected by income and the interest rate. For example, if you consume more than before because you got a pay raise, you will demand more money. And if the interest rate increases, you will be less encouraged to consume it and more interested in saving it in the bank. Let's do the same exercise. Imagine the central bank lowers the interest rate as an expansionary monetary policy. This will increase the supply of money since firms and consumers will be less encouraged to save it in the bank. Consumers will demand more money, which will increase consumption. Also, lower interest rates imply lower cost of borrowing, so investment is also expected to increase. As a result, aggregate demand will increase as well. Now let's do the same exercise for monetary policy. What examples of contractionary monetary policy can you think of? If you answered raising interest rate, raising reserve requirement for banks, or selling treasury bonds, you are correct. A higher interest rate discourages investment and consumption. Higher reserve requirement for banks means that they are more restricted with lending and circulating money. And finally, when the central bank sells treasury bonds, it receives money that is withdrawn from circulation. Which are the most common mistakes? Public policy does not always aim to increase GDP. contractionary policy seeks to diminish the effect of inflation. Also, countercyclical policy could be the example of Keynesian theory, expansionary policy to offset economic recession. Or it can also be the other way around, contractionary policy to decelerate economic growth. This happens mostly in contexts where inflation starts to grow. So, to wrap up, public policy, according to Keynesian economics, can work as a stabilizer for the economy. Both monetary and fiscal policy have effects on aggregate demand and can operate as stabilizers. So next time you read the newspaper, analyze news such as the Fed increases the interest rate or the government cuts public spending. Which type of public policy are those? And what are the aim of those policies? Hope you have enjoyed this video. And also, if you want to learn more about the topic, feel free to explore on Chegg.